forgot to bring your thing.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. Yes, sir. I just washed my hands.
It's all right.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Some preliminary effort at putting together the budget. You have an agenda there before you, and we'll try to stay with that as close as possible. And as far as time, we'll take whatever time's necessary, and if we don't finish, then we'll finish up at our next scheduled budget workshop. So with all that said, is there any other business we need to take care of before we start?
Mr. Chairman, if I may.
Yes, sir.
If you would go ahead and add number 15 to your agenda. And that is Stop It, S-T-O-P-I-T. Stop It.
Okay.
That'll make more sense.
Is that one word or two?
One.
Okay.
All right. We will start with number one. And for those of you who don't have the benefit of the agenda, it's the engineering report on Kepler Elementary School. Board members have the engineering report that was prepared on February the 22nd by Spoke & Wilson Consulting Engineers. And I think everybody's had a chance to briefly look over that, a three-page document, I believe. And so I'll turn it over to whoever's going to speak to the matter.
Mr. Wilson, if you'll come on up.
Give us your name, please.
My name is Steve Wilson. I'm the owner of Spoden & Wilson Consulting Engineers in Kingsport. We are blessed to provide most of the structural engineering services in this region. Matter of fact, we're the structural engineer of record on the new middle school that just went out to bid in Sullivan County, and we're also working on the new high school at Sullivan County right now. And we were the structural engineer of record on your K through, at the time we did it, the K through 2 school. Right down here, is it still K through 2? Okay.
Pre-K through
2. Pre-K through 2, okay. I worked with Don Salt on that facility years ago. I have also looked at Rogersville City School, realize it's not part of your system in the past on school facilities, and have looked at other facilities in the past for Mr. Shedden and now Mr. Glass. When Mr. Glass contacted me about Kepler, and came down and he and I toured the facility. It reminded me of going with Don Salt years ago. We went to the Clinch School, I believe, and we looked at it structurally, and I gave a structural report then. I understand from just a kid that went to Central Heights Elementary in Sullivan County, I understand how important that facility is. I understand that my report may paint a worst case scenario there, and certainly there's some real dollars here. But my report is just looking at the bones of that structure. It's not looking at who's in that structure. It's not looking at the people in that structure. It's not looking at the fabric of that community. And that's as equally important in that facility as anything I might say about it. That being said, what's paramount to me as an engineering registrant in the state of Tennessee, and to give you professional advice, is the end user that we're looking at is the safety and welfare of the inhabitants of that structure and the best feasibility and benefit to this Board of Education. That being said, as you know, the structure does have some age on it. The structure is predominantly a one-story structure with the original building predominantly out of wood framing and multi-wife or multiple layers of brick masonry bearing walls. There are interior piers and interior wood beams, and generally the floor joists span from exterior wall to corridor wall, corridor wall to corridor wall, and then corridor wall to the exterior wall in that fashion. If we call this direction or toward Rogersville, I got a little bit of turnaround with down there. I always try to keep north in my bearings, but if we call Rogersville north of there, I believe that's the way I referenced it in the report. I would call the front of the building east, toward the southeast corner of the front of the original building. There's a significant sag in the reframing. There is some failure is a strong word, but certainly some significant deformations in some of the roof structural framing members, and there is a fairly large depression in the roof. The roof is a very slight slope of wooden structure. It does have a ridge. Matter of fact, when I first looked at it, until Mr. Glass pointed out to me, we went up on the hill a little bit to kind of get a little more of a perspective. I really thought it was a flat roof, but it does have some slope to it, but not a great deal of slope. And that southeast corner in particular had quite a bit of sag and deformation. Obviously, it's wood floor joist. We did look at the foundation. There are deformations and sags and things of that nature going on in the floor framing system. Comparatively, a few years ago, and it was in the press, when I had to look at Bluffville Middle School in Sullivan County, and by the way, that was the junior high that I went to, it was a wood-framed, multi-wide brick building, and most of the joists in that building were fire-cut. That is, they were beveled on the ends as they were buried into the multi-wide brick. The reason they were designed that way, of course, Bluffville was a two-story building, but the reason they're designed that way in the old days, so to speak, were if you had a fire, if the building were involved in a fire situation and the joist started collapsing, they would fall out of the wall without pulling the brick walls down. And so you do have some multi-wife brick bearing here, but I could not tell if they're fire cut or not, okay? But what was happening at Bluffville years ago, and I don't mean to keep going back comparing you to anything in Sullivan County, but the building walls were moving and the joists were losing bearing, and there were in some places there was only a half an inch of bearing left and you had kids in there. So we, Spoden Wilson, me namely, at a board work session similar to this, had to recommend to that Board of Education to close the building down until repairs were made, and we did that. I tell you all that to tell you there's nothing at Kepler that told me to shut the building down, okay? I didn't find anything remotely unsafe, but yet I was asked to give a structural assessment and kind of a long-term snapshot, if you will, of what might be feasible and what that facility might be looking at. So when I do that, and I think long-term, us structural engineers, we try to design something the last 50 years, and we have plenty of structures that have. And we've had some structures that we designed that have now been torn down because they cycled out of the programming of whatever that entity was. But I would generally look, if someone asked me to look at it long-term, I would look at a 20-25 year window of a structure. But on this one, I looked at it more like 10 years and 15 years. And so our recommendations were kind of based on that snapshot in time or looking at a window of 10 to 15 years, would you want to try to prolong or continue use of that structure the way it is in some fashion for the next 10 or 15 years? So that being said, the introduction page and the information through the first 9 bullets are just describing what the existing building consists of. And I should point out, I think it was Beeson and Beeson did an addition to the north end. Again, I'm calling the Rogersville end the north end. And it's a one-story slab on grade, steel bar joist with gypsum roof deck and lightweight concrete deck with a membrane built up and then a membrane roof over that. That north addition was built later of similar footprint of the original. And then, of course, to the south, you have the gymnasium and the cafeteria. And the cafeteria has wood framing and steel bar joist framing as well. And then there are crawl spaces and some partial basement space under that. And of course, the original boiler room, we went into that as well. As I said, and I'll just quote from the report, based on the above observations and the general overall poor to fair, and I said, albeit well-maintained. It is well-maintained school. There's a lot of pride in that school. They take care of it. Your system obviously takes care of it, but from a structural perspective, it would be best to call it fair, okay? At worst, to call it poor. Nothing imminent, but that's just my assessment of the condition of the building. Of many of the existing structural elements throughout the facility, and with consideration of attempting to maintain school in said facility, and with further consideration of extending the life and function of the facility for another 10 to 15 years. Again, I told you we'd normally look at 25, but we focused this one down in a 10 or 15 year period. We would recommend strong consideration of following systematic structural upgrades and or remediation. It would be my structural recommendation on the original building to remove all of the deflected and damaged reframing members. If you're going to do that, excuse the expression, but I don't think you really want to attempt it from a structural, surgical, retrofit, remediation point of view and be, excuse the expression, but a penny-wise dollar foolish. I think if you start surgically repairing one area, you're just going to expand that original building into replacing the reframing system, okay? Just in a practical sense, in a facilitation point of view. But to do that, and if you're going to maintain school or maintain some occupancy and or you're going to try to do this in summer and phase it, you're also going to have to consider you're not going to de-roof the entire original building at one time. So we looked at, you would take one side of the building and perhaps do it, then you would do it over the corridor, then you would do it over the other side of the building. So when we arrived at an estimated number of $455,000 for that item, keep in mind phasing plays a big part in derivation of that number as well. Okay. And I think both buildings, the original building, and I'll call it the Beeson and Beeson because I work with Beeson Luskin Street Architects, the Beeson and Beeson North Edition, I think they're in the magnitude of 6,000-7,000 square feet each, if I'm not mistaken. I mean, they're, or maybe 9,000 square feet. They're 70 yeah, by 9,000, excuse me. So when you look at those numbers, you're in and around of that demolition, retrofit of structure, phasing and all, you're probably in the range of $50 a square foot of that repair. Yeah, I misspoke when I said 7,000. They're closer to 9,000. I think the one building, the original building is close to 100 foot long and the addition was close to 140 foot long and they're about 70 foot wide, 66 to 70 foot wide. So that was what was covered in item A, and again, we're recommending just replacement of the existing reframing system, therefore new joist, new framing members, new roof decking, new roof membrane, insulation. I'll tell you later in the report, but there's other incidentals like ceilings and lights and electrical and coordination like that that seriously could impact these numbers, but they're not really in those numbers because it's not my area of expertise to advise you on those.
Can you estimate a percentage add-on that we would consider for those kind of items?
Off the cuff, 25 to 30%. Is that low? You have a lot of experience with coordinating these items.
Depending on what finishes are chosen, yes. I mean, it could be a 50% increase.
When you're asking a structural engineer versus an architect or a contractor, you get a little bit different answer, but I would probably lean the 30% range, but okay. Then item B, We're recommending in the same building just to remove the floor joists and replace them. If we're going to go to the expense of retrofitting the roof, we ought to give it a real floor framing system and a real occupancy adaptable load capacity, okay? In a building of a school, your corridors on the first floor have to be designed to 100 pounds per square foot. Your classrooms can be designed for 40 pounds a square foot, but if you have mobile classrooms or you have multiple functioning classrooms, generally we design to 60 pounds a square foot. As far as adaptability of that current existing space and the current wood framing, it certainly lasted longer than I've been alive, but there are a lot of bumps and bruises. Even in the floor framing system, there's a lot of deflections, there's unlevel floor, there's some undulations in the floor, there have been some movements. Some of that movement is foundation, some of it's just framing members. So we were recommending replacement of that framing system. And because that's floor, and because you're attacking everything above you with the roof, this number came down in our estimate of $280,000. Okay.
In terms of process, would those be done simultaneously, or would one be before the other?
I would do roof first. First of all, it's more difficult. Secondly, you would want to scaffold or stage off of the floor. If you retrofit scaffolding, ladders, equipment, of course, a lot of that would be done from the exterior as well. But I guess the essence of this report is we were starting with the roof first. First of all, it was in the worst condition. Secondly, it's the most difficult to achieve. Probably requires even the most phasing because of ceiling, lights, conduits, and so forth. You have some of those same things with the floor. You could take the approach that if you did, say, the west side roof, and you did half of the roof, and then as you progress to the other half of the west side roof, you might overlap your schedule by coming back and starting the floor. But I would telescope the roof in front of the floor. In other words, I'd keep myself in the dry, for lack of a better word. Okay. The point is, when you start repairing the roof, you could have the roof open and try to tarp it or temporarily cover it in rain or whatever. You don't really want to be messing with the floor system if you don't have to during that. So ideally, you would want to telescope the roof repair and replacement in front of the floor, if that makes sense. Don't have to. You could do them both simultaneously, but to do them both simultaneously, of course, I guess from an occupancy point of view, you're going to close that particular room or that particular side of the building either way. The other thing is, are you going to do this each summer? Would you attack part of it in the summer when you have no prescribed occupancy? You're out of school. Do you try to do part of it, and then do you postpone to the next summer? The other half, you know, and that would have a difference. That would have a different impact too.
Could you accomplish this job in 2 months? Sounds like a pretty good size project.
I don't think so. I think at best it's 4 to 6 months per side. Yeah.
And I'm assuming if we're going to do all that, we're going to take all the inferior electrical systems out and plumbing that's there too. Would we not be doing that?
I keep deferring to Mr. Glass on these, but I don't.
Would we not?
If you're going this far structurally,
yeah,
it would only make sense.
Let me ask another question. When you referenced 10 to 15 years, why'd you do that instead of 20 to 25? Tell us what's behind that.
All right. If I'm designing you a structure from the ground up, I'm going to look at a 50-year life. If I'm looking at a structure that I'm adapting for you and I'm adding additions to, I'm probably going to look at 25-year life of the original structure. I think this one was in... This is an older structure related to the gym, cafeteria, and the main building. And us structural engineers are conservative. So I could only foresee that this surgical type repair that you would be looking at a 15-year serviceability window, okay? That being said, if it's done right, and it's done professionally, and it's done in accordance with our recommendations or someone similar to myself, and there are maybe even more specific plans drawn up, or there is a walkthrough and a pre-construction and a methodology developed with a reputable contractor, I could see the 15 years stretching, but by the same token, unless you replace everything, see, I guess what I'm saying, I'm biased in my report because I don't know if you're going to attack all of the HVAC and all the electrical and all the ceiling and all the lights, and is it going to be all LED and, you know, all the above? Or you know, so that brings the number down too, okay? But putting me to task, and no advertisement for Spoden & Wilson, if we design a repair for you, I'm just being ultra-conservative and a good steward to you, recommending 15 years, but I have every confidence any structural repair we recommend would last longer than we ever have to worry about.
You know, our thinking, though, is that if we're going to spend $2.5 million for 15 years, that may not be the wisest move.
Yes, sir.
So that's kind of where we need to put that in perspective, I believe.
Yes, sir. Well, and so when you get down to it, we were around $1.3 million for structural repair. If the $1.3 million in concert with the additional stuff happens and it's all professionally done, then the 15-year window grows. Okay? Obviously, in concert with the removal of the roof system over the main building, we also recommend removing or replacing the roof over the gym and the cafeteria area. For the long-term stability of that gym, I mean, you got a pretty good span, you got really tall walls, and they're multi-wife brick, and there is some cracking going on the south end, okay? Some of that's expansion and contraction cracking, some of it's been long-term settlement cracking. And of course, we have a number in there just to repoint masonry throughout. The north end on the Beeson & Beeson addition, I believe I'm right, it was Beeson & Beeson, right? See, I keep saying that, but it was typical of a Beeson addition, and boy, they did a bunch of them. The alcove on the north end of that building is some expansion, thermal expansion, cracking going on over the lintel and over the alcove entry. You get a long, narrow, skinny building, and you get expansive forces built up in the roof diaphragm, that's going to happen. So in the gym, we recommended replacing that roof and come back with steel bar joist and metal deck and membrane and insulated type system. And with the gym and the cafeteria, we had estimated that around $100,000. And then on the newer north end addition that is bar joist, just looking at that roof and looking at that membrane and looking at the gypsum underneath and where we can see it all, strong consideration ought to be given to re-skinning, re-membraning that roof. And that was estimated at $180,000.
As you have these listed, A, B, C, is that priority order?
It was in my mind, okay. But at the end of the day, you all the ones that are going to implement this. Nothing says that you can't redefine A through F, okay? But if you're asking my structural opinion, and you are, A through F was intentional in order, okay?
Thank you.
Before you move on, Mr. Wilson, one of the things that we had looked at earlier was doing a secure entrance to that particular school, and right now, Starnes, I don't remember our figure on what we had on that particular school for a secure entry. Mr. Glass, you remember?
I can tell you shortly.
I would assume if we were doing this kind of renovation, we would do that as well at the same time, wouldn't we?
I mean,
$200,000. Seems to me like $250,000 comes to my mind for that school. Is that?
I wouldn't think it was that high. I'm guessing 87 or somewhere in that neighborhood.
It just depends on if you're also doing bricks and mortar, for lack of a better word, with it. I mean, are you building new walls and new entry alcove and airlock, you know, and Knox boxing and all that? Again, I'm a structural engineer, but I deal with all these schools, so I'm not totally oblivious to some of the things you have to do, but I really don't have a feel. But 250 seems high, but 100 doesn't seem unreasonable.
That was a five-year-old estimate, I'm thinking. Don't hold me to there was that. Some high and there was some not so high.
I'm
probably going to be stuck up in another school, but we probably won't. So in terms, and I guess this is a Mr. Starnes question, on a project of this nature, we're not going to have students and staff there. Would we shuttle these kids to other schools while this project is ongoing?
We'd have to decide as a plan whether we would shuttle or whether we would consider putting mobile units. Of course, that's an additional cost. Probably talking, just my estimate, Sam would be better at this, but probably a double classroom, we'll estimate $40,000 a year or plus, something of that nature.
Right.
Close. Double classroom mobile, 40?
Yes.
So, thinking about the number of classrooms there and having a space for the office, you're going to have 4 to 5 double units, so you're talking $160,000 to $200,000 to rent mobile units during the construction. If you didn't bus and relocate to another school.
The other thing I need to caution you on the re-roofing and replacing the roof structure, and certainly Shannon in his previous life has a lot more experience to answer you on how a contractor might want to finally button that up and put the skin on it. I'm really looking at systematically replacing the structural members with structural members and metal decking, but keeping in mind you're trying to keep it dry and you're trying to retrofit that structure, but at some point there's going to be an insulation put on and an EPDM TPO type rubber membrane that perhaps that roofing contractor would want to do the whole entire roof at one time. Versus pieces and parts. I'm talking about just the skin itself. So within my number that I extrapolated for you, I kept in mind that there might be a temporary roofing or there might be, you know, a Band-Aid. I don't mean to imply that surgically the structure would be a Band-Aid, but I'm saying there might be a temporary intermediate skin put on to keep it dry as they progress and then come back with full membrane.
It could be staged. It could be staged, but... There again, you added the cost because you have to have temporary tie-ins, which you have to cut back out.
Right.
So, I mean.
Does the design of this school lend itself to a gable roof without having to take the old roof off? Go with the metal structure?
It would, except.
The kitchen area.
Well, the kitchen area, but. Probably just for span and not overloading the exterior walls, I would still, if we did that, I would try to devise a way to come up off the corridor walls. And so you would have a monoslope truss, and then a cantilevered condition in the middle. You certainly could do that, yes.
Would that save us any money going that route?
It would certainly save you demo cost.
You could leave the old structure and
yeah.
Just cover it.
Yeah. We can certainly look at that number. That might cut. It's irresponsible of me to throw this out without really getting into number, but you know that might cut out of maybe 260% of that number. Might cut it 40% out of it.
The security system would have to be entrance when Don did the. Presentation on it for Kepler was $51,610.
Okay. So 5 years ago or six?
But
yeah.
What was that just retrofitting to structure? It's there, Shannon? Or, I mean,
yes, that was adding on the front of the building. I actually have a
51 what?
$51,610. And that was presented in, sorry, 2013, August of 2013.
Let me ask this. This is a dumb question probably, but construction for new school, what's that looking at today, square footage-wise?
I'm fully cognizant that the press is here, and I don't want to keep referring to Sullivan County, but we just bid the middle school. I want to give you a range because I know what the total middle school bid was, and I know what our square footage was, but there are soft costs in any building project. Architectural fees, permitting fees, and quite frankly, a new school facility, the permitting fees with the state of Tennessee are pretty significant. As far as review fees at the fire marshal, there's also design fees, land cost, all of that. So I think for building proper, you ought to consider $175 to $190 a square foot. And I can remember 32 years ago, it was a blanket, $100 a square foot, you could build anything, okay? No. Well, I also tell you, my company did the original Dobbins Bennett, and if you're thinking about the size and magnitude of a Dobbins Bennett, that was built for $13 a square foot in 1968. And site and all was $17 a square foot. I'm not sure you could drive by it for that. I mean, but in reality, if you're going out here and finding a new site and preparing it and building the building, I would hover 190 to 200. If you're just talking about building proper, probably 175 to 190.
Okay. Square footage, again, is around 18,000, Shannon, is that right?
Right.
Somebody do the math right quick. I'm just interested, not that that's where we're going. 3.6 if it's $200.
Yeah, 3.42.
3.42.
But I would say you are closer to 19,000 there, aren't you? If I might have those. I didn't bring the entire file, and I'll
probably. 109, correct?
Huh?
You said
109,
correct? 200.
Yeah.
Oh, that's what I did different.
Okay.
219,000 square feet, 3.8
million. 19,000. Yeah, 3.8 million. Now, there's not space on that property to construct another school while you're using one school.
Now, I don't want to bias you at all, but from a structural perspective, and you said, how can we get the most bang for our buck? Do we retrofit these down and build over? Because it's bar joist, because it's slab on grade, because the only thing... Not advocating it. I'm just saying from the structural perspective, the slab on grade, bar joist building, keep it, tear everything else down and build back. I mean, I could see some architect giving you that advice, okay? That's purely from a structural perspective, though, and programmatically it may not work. You know, I mean, as far as space relationships, ingress, egress, it may not work.
Right. So you're probably talking... $2 million,
yeah,
to do that.
Yeah.
You can very easily get into a retrofitting and trying to use the other structure over $2 million.
Yeah.
Safe to say.
How many years would that be invested in that the life and function? Is that?
Oh, if you built a new building again, Dobbins Bennett was built in 67, Sullivan Central was built in 68, and Sullivan East and they're going to use Sullivan Central as a middle school after we get the high school done. I mean, 50 years, it would be a programmatic function. Believe me, 25 years into a 50-year building program, you find out how out of date you are on systems and programming, but I'm saying as far as structure, okay? As far as the beams, the columns, the footings, the foundation walls, we look at a 50-year life, okay? That doesn't mean that you plan the room the right size for 50 years, or, you know.
But I did hear you say that the facility is safe for usage.
Yes. I will say this. The one codicil or clarification to that, the southeast corner roof depression, I would address it before long. I don't see anything imminent, but it is a fairly significant depression, and we've had strange winter for sure. I'd be surprised if they're not, but again, it was just a one-story building. So it's just a crawl space.
But you were unable to see that, right?
I wasn't able to see it, but the reason I don't know is, yes, I could not see it, but then also, if I don't want it to sound this simplistic, but if you were designing that building 50 years ago and you're worried about the joists falling out of the wall, they weren't falling that far, so they really couldn't pull the walls in.
Oh, okay.
So they,
that was my concern.
Yeah, they may or, I mean, the catenary effect of it being involved in a fire and the joists wanting to pull out of the walls, you worry about that more in multi-story or on second floor. I guess what I'm saying, though, with wood and brick masonry, the walls move around and the wood moves around. And then all of a sudden you get a sag or you get a deformation or, you know.
I'm surprised there's no termite damage in a wood structure. Was it pretty sound? Shannon, you've been in the crawl space?
There actually have been several rooms that have already been refloored due to termites. And that's even before I got here. Bill had, I think, two classrooms they had totally put in new joists and refloored. The old section. The new section slab on gray. Yeah. Termites are not.
If Mr. Glass wants and it's your all's will or choice, I am happy to crawl through it all and look at that before you make a final decision on anything. But I did not specifically. The point is, I looked at enough structure, I'm recommending you replace it. But if you're wanting an assessment, is it still safe to occupy everywhere and you want me to look at that, I'll be happy to. Okay.
Not sure, Mr. Glass, probably crawl under there.
I don't think there's any active termite. I mean, nothing I saw. I mean, I think it's been abated or treated or mitigated.
Yeah. So on the southeast corner of that roof, is it actually holding water?
Looks like it.
Are we leaking right there, Shannon?
Not now.
It's a matter of time, I guess.
It has leaked there before. And for that is the, if you come in the front door, turn right to go down the hallway toward the classrooms, it's the first classroom on the right. I think Jacinda Trent's in there right now.
So how much water cooling up there?
At worst, 3 inches.
It's pretty good.
But maybe four. I mean, it's really hard to tell. I guess for us to totally answer you on that, we would have to get up on top of it and have a straight edge to lay it, because it is on a slope, but the slope will fool you. It looks flat until you get up to enough height or perspective you can see the ridge.
And you also have some foam insulation up there that if it's got wet, it's compressed. So until you actually take the roofing off, you're not going to know how much the deck is deflected. We know it has some, but as far as an actual, I can tell you it's deflected 3 inches. I can't until we pull everything off. So,
Shane, do you have the, remember the original part of the school that we're talking about? It was built in the late 50s?
It was built in 1950.
1950.
The expansion 61? Was done in 1960.
50 and 60.
Yes.
Thank you.
And they both are a little older than me.
You just clouded the water even more.
What's that?
I'm sorry, but I just said you clouded the water even more. No, you've done a very thorough report and evaluation, and we do appreciate it. And it's,
the other thing I will caution you, all of us engineers are a little leery of it. I developed to you the budget numbers based on our experience and all of our many projects of school work. Real numbers ought to be derived by a contractor that would actually be doing the work. So while you can rely on these are our best guess, I would not rely on them in absolutely making the final monetary decision of anything, because I just had a job this year that we had estimated structural repairs of $800,000 to $1 million, and they bid for $500,000. And then I had a job, we estimated the repairs around $200,000, and they bid for $350,000. So sometimes it's the bidding climate, sometimes it's the availability of this contractor or that, or how busy they are, or petroleum prices, steel prices, it's all very volatile and all fluctuate. So
we still have QSCAD grant for the HVAC system that we currently have, is that right? And is it all window units, room units, individual room units, or is it barred units?
We're talking about putting in all the classrooms and different things. Now there is a rooftop unit that wasn't part of that that's over the kitchen. All right. To put the steel structure up there to support some of that stuff, or is that exhaust fan?
That's exhaust fan. Yeah, as far as HVAC, everything is wall hung or windmill.
Okay.
Of the mini split is in the
kitchen,
and one in the dining hall.
And we have new windows in the old section too, right?
Yes.
I assume we would leave those, or would we update the HVAC and go with a central system when we're doing this kind of issue?
I think the plus of the bar units, and when we had talked before, we talked about actually repurposing those, relocating those type things. But the bar units versus a central system, when a unit goes down, it affects one classroom.
Right.
Versus when a central unit goes down, it affects the entire school. So I think from that feasibility standpoint, it's much better to have individual units. And that's been kind of the model we went through with most of our. Now there's a large common area, so to speak, and we use rooftop units for our cafeterias and those type of things on a lot of our buildings.
Well, this school has the new lighting system as well, doesn't it? Didn't we receive grant money to install new lighting in the school? Is that able to repurpose that, or is that something that would go away when you do total renovation?
I mean, if you were doing a total renovation, I would actually go to LED. T8s are kind of, the technology moves so quick. You know, T12s were going out, so we did T8s. Then T5s came along. Now nobody wants fluorescent. It's time to go LED. So it's really not worth
repurposing to repair other lights that we have in place or whatever. Of course, we have to be stored enough.
Back to your question on life cycle, these are the things that really affect life cycle that I can't answer for you. I'm just talking structural. Again, I'm talking the bones of the building. But the infrastructure, plumbing, HVAC, lighting, electrical, it's all changing so rapidly of what you're going with and what type of system.
Yeah, we have that's one of the things that if you're going to renovate that building, you were asking about the restrooms and the plumbing. That's all galvanized piping, so it needs to come out. I mean, if you're going to pull it, you need to pull it off.
And this would trigger an ADA.
Well, once you, if you're going this far on a renovation, yes, you have to bring it up to code. So then you're going to have an ADA compliance issue, because right now we're before that time. We're making adjustments for that. But once you start renovating, you have to bring up the current code.
I think the key, I don't want to misspeak, I think the key is defining rehabilitation and repair versus renovation. I think that's the real key.
Have you had any experience with what they would call this project?
Oh, I think this, if you did everything we've discussed, it would be renovation. Yeah. I think you would be into ingress-egress issues, ADA issues.
So, and that's not addressed at all in any of this, is it?
No.
The last paragraph on the second page notes that it's not included.
Yeah.
And that could drive those numbers.
Yes.
Less higher, I guess. Talking about taking out all the galvanized plumbing, replumbing, and remapping. Okay, any other questions of Mr. Wilson?
I will caution, too, because I'm blessed to do most of the structural, and I do a whole lot of the civil as far as site. You also get into ADA compliance issues, not only ingress, egress to your building proper, but parking, access to your site, access to your other facilities. I mean, it does mushroom. It's important, but it does mushroom. It does grow exponentially when you start looking at facility.
Okay. I want to say thank you very much.
Yes, sir.
Thank you. Thank you.
Sure.
Thank you, Mr. Clark.
Yes, sir.
I'd like to hear your all's thoughts. Starting with Jackie, what's your thoughts on this?
Versus what it would cost to build a new building. I mean, by the time we get done, we're going to be at that point anyway, aren't we? Real close. And the benefit of that, the newer, we have a longer lifespan.
Yeah, I agree.
I think that much money is some.
I think so, too.
Yep. And that?
Senior has to add the money to busing everybody out of that school while they build a new one, because there's nowhere to put the new one without you take down the old.
Exactly.
So you'd have a lot of cost.
Just be one bus, because we're already busing middle school age and high school age kids anyway. We only be busing the elementary students. So basically, there's three buses that service that area. It would be the expense of one bus coming on into Rockford, which is about 8 or 9 miles.
Would all those students be shuttled to one school, or would it be split?
K-3 or K-2 would go to Joseph Rogers, and 3-5 would go to Hopkins Elementary.
Can they handle 100 students between the two schools?
Yes.
Well, if they can handle 100 students, why don't we just send 100 students there?
That's the question. Oh, there's 4 to 6 months to renovate. Then what's the estimate of the time frame?
I think the 4 to 6 months, if I'm not mistaken, is just one portion of it.
I think you would systematically do 4 to 6 months in three or four different phases.
Okay. If you're going to demolish and start over, you're talking 2 years or more.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Wow. I think any school project is very ambitious to get anything under 18 months. you might as well plan 20. I mean, if you're starting from ground zero on any school facility, you've got to program 24 months of design and.
And that's just one school.
We got some other schools that have significant issues too.
Any other thoughts or comments? Looks like it could exceed $2 million real quick.
I think if you do this and you get into the ADA and you try to retrofit everything, you're going to end up touching so much that it's actually going to be more. Again, I'm not a contractor or architect or engineer, but just my opinion, I think it's going to end up being higher cost than it will be demolished and start on.
Do we own any other property in that community?
We do not.
And it just lends itself to build it and use the one we're in the way it's.
No, the way it's laid out, you do get down, you have to go to the other side of the treatment plant, so you'll be getting pretty close to the creek there's probably. And even if you were going to try to keep people on site and do mobile units, again, that's probably not a good way to do that. If you were going to try to do that, then you basically cover up just about every bit of the pavement in the back, if not more of the pavement, encroach probably on the softball field, plus all the temporary plumbing that would have to go into that, and it'd be a substantial cost to try to remain on site.
Any if you show students for 2 years to these schools, they would probably be acclimated going to these schools in 2 years. While trying to do this renovation.
In a popular opinion, but that's what we do. If we have lines at the schools for these children, popular, but it makes them work. It seems they want to do that.
When Joseph Rogers first opened up, we had 7 classrooms for each grade. Now we have 5 currently. Each grade. So there is space. There's space in Hopkins Elementary. And we talked about that previously.
Would all the teachers be absorbed?
Couldn't tell you without looking specifically at numbers, but I would say that most of the teachers would travel with the students and there would be a class, an additional class in each grade level.
Depending on class size, right? That would be the deciding factor. Okay, let's move on. Number 2, it's approval to pay alternative school administrator on the elementary principal pay scale instead of high school assistant principal pay scale. Assuming that we are currently paying them on the high school assistant, is that the situation?
Yes, that's correct. That's correct. And I guess a little bit of history. When we first opened up the alternative school, alternative school were required to have by code for grades 7 through 12. We do put 6th graders there by approval on a case-by-case basis. But we serve 6 through 12 there.
How many instructors do you have?
We have a math, English, science, social studies instructor. We have a special ed teacher there, a counselor. Basically 6 teachers and an administrator there. Looking at the size of it and some of our smaller elementary schools, the responsibilities there, felt like that there was a need. The administrator at the alternative school, like I said, has pretty much the same responsibilities as a principal. To do that, looking at the 2 scales, to do that would end up being, I have this math worked out, just a second. On this year's wages, using the scales and everything, the difference would be $794.20.
$794.20 plus corresponding benefits.
That would be total salary. It would not include PCRS overtime pay. Yes.
Good. Anybody have any questions on that?
We can't vote on everything, but would there be a recommendation to figure to calculate the budget that way?
Why is it different?
At the time, since the school doesn't have a number, and what that means is that school, every school we have, the 18 schools, are assigned a school number by the state.
Okay.
This is a more, it's viewed as a program. And since it was viewed as a program originally, felt that it would be an administrator, and that administrator would be an assistant underneath all the other schools. When in reality of it is, that person's responsible for that building, all the staff within that building, all the students within that building, they're responsible for that school, even though it doesn't have a school number. I think that was the thought process behind it originally.
Do you have an average census of students?
It varies. I think there were somewhere around 40 students there the other day when I was by there.
Does that seem to be the average?
40 to 50. And sometimes it's less. At certain times of the year it could be more, but probably, yes, probably a good average, 40 to 50.
The principal, is he on a 10-month schedule, or what's his work?
Assistant principals are 11 months, the same as principals.
So he's currently on 11 months?
Mm-hmm.
He would remain there?
She.
He would remain there?
Yes. She does a fine job.
Is anybody opposed to that measure? Just by a nod of the head or shake of the head? That seemed to be unreasonable to me. Good. Athletic trainers, 12 months, and then I assume that means they're on a 12-month schedule. You know what that's about?
Yes. Right now, currently, trainers are on an 11-month schedule. And in reality, we say 11-month schedule versus 12-month schedule. We'll start off with 10-month schedule. 10-month schedule is 200 days. 180 days for students, 10 days of in-service, and 10 days for vacation that are factored in to a 200-day calendar. When we say 220 days, that means another 10 days after school's out and then 10 days before school starts. Then the two high school principals are 240, 12-month. Central office and custodians and maintenance and those folks are a 12-month, 260-day calendar. So we have 200, 220, 240, and 260. The 200, 220, 240, they operate on the school schedule when school's closed for snow or not required to be there. Fall break, spring break, they get out, get all the holidays that the school does, and they work extra days. The reality of it, as we well know, is that during Christmas break, we play in holiday tournaments. The trainers are working. During fall break and spring break, athletics are still going on. So again, trainers are still working. In the summer, except for the two-week dead periods we referred to, the last week of June, the first week of July, with basketball camps and baseball and football and all those things that are going, getting ready for golf season, getting ready for all these different things. So they're keeping hours and working pretty much around the year except for those 2 weeks. Now, obviously, their schedule may be, altered. I think say even during the year it's altered. If there's going to be a ball game tonight, there's no use for them to come in at 8 o'clock in the morning. They're going to come in the afternoon because they're going to be there until about 11 o'clock at night, or like for 10 o'clock at least. So they may work 2 to 10 or something of that nature. So just recognizing this, we had a long-standing trainer. I think she was with us for about 18 years, if I'm not mistaken, and just left. I went to another system and received a sizable increase and ended up working a month less. So to make sure that we are fairly compensating our trainers and everything, I would be my recommendation for these 2 people to move them to the 12-month, 240 days versus the 11-month, 220.
How many athletic trainers do we have?
Two.
One of your team and one volunteer.
What's the total financial impact?
If you look at the scale, and Melissa, where did you make that move on here? You have that? You have that. Okay. I have that too. I apologize. The total financial impact would basically be 2 months' salary, $7,287.70.
Each?
No, combined.
$7,287.70.
Again, that's based on the additional systems. Like I said, the one with 11 months with us, she went to a particular school, but I think they have multiple trainers, and she was going to work 10 months there. But she received close to $18,000 to $20,000 raise. So, again,
why would you do that?
I'm sure she had her reasons, but it is a very important position, and to be fair to those people who are working the time, should be compensated. But again, that's my opinion.
Have they not been compensated any other way prior to this?
They're paid a salary.
They don't give comp time or anything like that off when they're
sports and sports things. They're working. And you'll see, like I said, other than the 2 week quote dead period just referred to by PSSAA, we pretty much have events going. Like I said, you'll have all your summer activities, basketball camps and baseball camps and football practices, preseason practice, which starts soon after, 7-on-7 leagues, those type things. You'll have just rough estimates. Football practices are probably going to start after that about 2 weeks after that dead period. Official football practice probably starts.
Are these tenured, certified folks, or are they?
They are certified as trainers. They're not certified as teachers. They're certified as trainers. That is one of our requirements, that they be nationally board certified.
So they don't receive tenure?
No.
What pay scale are they currently on? Are they on the teacher scale, or are they on a separate trainer
set scale?
This is it. Or stopping for having advanced degree.
It's a different level. You see a bachelor's degree, master's degree on the scale. But they would not receive a supplement like a coach would, but over and above their teaching pay, for example. That's their sign on the job duties.
All right. Thoughts on that? As far as the budget matter. I'm good with it. I think we pay people for what they do. Anybody opposed to doing that? Seeing no one objecting, but ask you to put that in the budget, Mr. Starnes. Okay. Number four, schedule replacement of three maintenance vans, purchase of one mower, and discussion of water jetter purchase, whatever a water jetter is.
Water jetter.
You'll know what that is in a minute. Obviously, three vans, and we started this last year trying to get our maintenance vehicles and our technology vehicles and those type things on a replacement schedule. We budgeted $45,000 in this current year's budget. We bought a truck, a little over $16,000 four-wheel drive truck. We bought a van. We got a really good deal at $20,000. And there's about $80-some-hundred left that we're going to try to get a minivan or something like that for technology. So that's the $45,000 that we had budgeted. What we want to do next year is we do need three maintenance vans. We have three of them that are getting up there, high mileage, and starting to present some issues. We want to replace those. We budgeted that based on the purchase of our last van.
Is this one of the technology vans, or this is not a technology van?
We have money right now we're trying to use to replace the technology.
So I understand it's on its last leg, right?
We did do some repair work to it and it's in better shape. But if we were looking at that, our last van purchase was $20,000, so if we budgeted for three of those, that would be $60,000. Purchase of a mower, we were able to get our last mowers for a little under $10,000, but that's subject to. But we need a mower on our schedule that we started on when we took the mowing back over. We were going to start getting into that. So we would retire one of our mowers that we had and get on that replacement. So I would at least recommend budgeting probably $12,000 for a mower. So that would get us to $72,000. A water jetter. When we call it Little River, you come and unclog a drain for us or whatever. Instead of bringing the old Tommy Auger type thing and have the metal ball that slaps around inside of that, that becomes problematic when you're dealing with ductile iron piping. If I get over my head here, bail me out, okay?
You're doing good.
You don't want that slapping around inside of that and breaking those, potentially breaking those tile and everything on the inside when you're trying to unclog a drain. So what we've gotten to is a system where you fish a hose down there and it has, it's like a pressure washer, that you're unclogging the drain with high pressure water. It's a lot safer, a lot easier on our pipes, but it's very efficient on the clogs. Also, there's things that you can fit under that, the cameras on, so we can inspect lines. So right now, an average, probably when we call the road router to come out and unclog the drain, we're probably paying $800-1,200 per visit. So if we would invest that money in getting our own water jetter, getting it outfitted, estimating about $10,000 for that purchase. Of course, 10 trips with River, and we potentially bought that. So even if we were only calling them three or four times a year, this would pay for itself in about 3 years.
Does it include the camera system as well?
No.
Just don't we need a camera system to determine what our problems are?
I mean, potentially, yes, they're helpful, but we'll take what we can get.
We're estimating 10 with this water jetter. I'd say the camera system is another 5.
Five to 7, yeah. You might find it's all dependent on how far you want to go. I mean, if you want 100 foot of cable, it's a lot cheaper than if you get 250. So it's all dependent on what attachment you get. The jetter is basically a pressure washer that goes in, but you have to buy a line. The more line you put on it, the bigger jetter you have to have. So, I mean, it just depends. A lot of times, if it's one that's in close, we can actually get it with an auger. We do have one of the old type, spring type augers. And if it's if it's close, we can get to it. We'll get it stopped. It's, you know, 20, 30 foot down. But when you start stretching those augers out through 250 feet of line, and you've got them, they're basically like springs. I mean, they lock together, but they're basically like a bunch of springs, steel cables, and they just slap the inside of that ductile pipe. And it breaks it. Or clay. We actually have some, we just got rid of our last clay pipe at Mount Carmel.
So, having said all that, we're probably talking about 60 for the vans, mower at a minimum of 12, and a jetter with a camera, probably 15. So, it's 2760, probably $87,000, roughly. So, adding another 40 to our equipment line of maintenance if we wanted to be able to do all these.
How many mowers will that make now, Shannon, that you're actually operating?
We operate four constantly, but we've got an old Yazoo, you know, it's like a 36 horse diesel that might be the first zero turn that was here. I'm not real sure. It's pretty old. And then we have an X Mark, and then we have the two John Deeres that we bought last year.
So, which one are you going to retire?
The Yazoo.
That's what they sent to office with?
No.
That's separate. That's not included in those four hours to mow out of school.
Oh, yeah, that's a fifth one. I forget about him because he don't mow the schools. He mows central office, the retention ponds, that kind of thing. So I kind of forget about
him. Three men mowing.
We got four. Five, if you count central office. We got five that mow constantly.
So the water jetter, you're adding $5,000 to that estimate?
For that, of 10, I would say 5.
And 15 for the
15,
camera.
12.
Because we're having to either borrow or we're having to rent a camera on occasion, aren't we?
Roto-Rooter does it. If we call them in to jet a line, they'll run the camera while they're there.
Including that? For no extra charge?
Well, I mean, it's a service charge, so they're going to charge us regardless, so I just go ahead and have them run the camera usually if we have a, you know, if we have something, which is actually how we found the collapsed line at Sigourneville. We had called them the first time to jet the line coming out of the special ed area back on the, it's on the right side of the gym there, that hallway.
Can you use the camera for supply side instead of sewer to know if you've got a break? It's only for sewer lines.
Well, I mean, you can't. You wouldn't run it in a pressurized line.
Well, I mean,
You'd have to let the pressure out, but I doubt you would ever see it because most of the time when you have a leak on a pressure line, it's basically just a small crack. I mean, when you have a collapsed sewer line, that's what we had there. It was a ductile. A ductile iron pipe that was flat. It had actually collapsed from the top. So.
It'd be hard to get it into a 1-inch supply. Probably couldn't get it into a 1-inch supply after you did it.
The camera that they use is made by Rigid, and it's probably about the size of your thumb. It's not very large.
You can usually tell where your water break is, can't you?
Oh yeah. Usually that's not a problem. It'll either come up or come down, whichever.
All right, so it looks like on number four we're talking about $60,000 for the vans, 12 for the mower, and
15 for the water jetter with camera
for a total of $87,000. Okay. Is there any opposition to that? Okay. Looks like that's somewhat favorable. Number five is assessment district-wide benchmark grade 3 end of course. entering into course exam? Is that the assessment we're talking about?
One of the things that has changed back in 2014-15, when Hopkins County was recognized as an exemplary district, we had worked over time and had a program called Global Scholar. We had a district-wide benchmark that we were administering 3 times a year, and it was helping us to assess our student mastery of the standards. It was helping us to assess mastery toward the cumulative standards for the year, helping us to adjust our instruction by knowing exactly what our kids were learning and where they were performing, what areas of deficit they had, those type of things. When we changed standards, the state at that time talked about developing a benchmarking system. Finally, this spring, mid-January, they released a program called CAB, or Classroom Assessment Goal. It is very limited, and it was built more, I think, to be used by teachers as a more formative type assessment than an interim summative assessment. And there's still benefits to it. There's also released items. So there are some ways to assess kids using the same kind of test items that they will see on the 10-ready test. But there's no reporting functionality with that. It would be more like incorporating those items into quizzes, into unit tests, those type of things within the classroom. To get us a true benchmark program to look at this, and the staff has looked at the multiple programs and everything. And the one we've kind of settled on is, and we feel the best about, is a program called, it actually says TE21, but it's referred to as CASE, C-A-S-E. Program is used by American City Schools, used by Oak Ridge, used by Germantown. When you look at those three school systems, Germantown is probably the highest performing school system in the state of Tennessee. We all know very well about Maryville, Oak Ridge, those type of things. According to the salesman, Germantown was able to have about 97% predictability using this benchmark assessment of how their students would score on 10-ready assessment. We feel that this would be something that would really benefit our students to be able to do that, and our teachers to assess where they was at. To be able to implement 2 benchmark assessments per year. So basically one somewhere around the beginning of November, another one end of February, 1st of March, somewhere like that. Looking at implementing 2 benchmark assessments. Those would be custom benchmark assessments designed off the state blueprints, and using the same type of questions that our students would see on the 10-ready assessment. You see that quote there for a 1-year total would be $3 per student for the platform, the software to be able to do that, $8 per student for 2 benchmarks per year, and then $1,000 for the data fee. And what that means is full data pulls, 5 pulls per year. And that would be uploading information into the system to pull and extract information from Skyward, our student management system. So when we did test results, we could get similar disaggregation that we would see on state testing. Then you see $1,000 for training. Grand total based on the number of students, and this could go down a little bit. What we did basically was took our are second grade through 10th grade currently, bump them up, looking at this as a third grade through EOC. In our high school, being on the block schedule, we could potentially be less than 17-17 because not everybody would be taking two tests a year, just depending on their schedule. They could very well take two tests a year. But, quote, based on that, it's $58,738.
What grades again is this impact?
It would impact third grade through eighth grade. And then when I say EOC, I mean the high school. We give 9 end of course assessments in high school. We have English 1, English 2, English 3. We have Algebra 1, Geometry, Algebra 2. We have Biology, Chemistry, and U.S. History.
So we really understand, is this a test that the students...
It would be a test, assessment. The students would take one in the fall, 3 through 8, another test in the spring. It would assess their progress toward mastery as an individual student. Then also would provide insight into the teacher, what have my students learned that we've taught. Plus, if we decided to do cumulative type tests in the fall and cumulative type tests in the spring, the one in the spring is definitely going to be a full year cumulative type test.
Who scores the test? Is this company?
The program is sourcing. The program scores the test.
What's the turnaround in getting the information back to the teacher to incorporate that into their...
The individual grading of the test when the kid finishes submitting, correct me if I'm wrong, when the kid puts submitted into the test, it automatically grades it, then they would generate reports. The teacher would be able to generate a report or that, so it would be a really quick turnaround.
How does this fit in with the other testing that's already mandated by the state?
Right now, we have AIMS-WEB, which is a universal screener for grades 3 through 8. We administer that test, and it's a shorter test. We administer that test to determine students' reading and math performance, and they would give that test in August, December, and May. We would, as I said, probably look to do this test. It would be at each subject, English, math, science, social studies, 3 through 8, and then the 9 EOCs. We would look to give that test for 3 through 8 sometime about the first week of November, probably last week of October, somewhere in that schedule. Then last week, February, first week of March, or that time frame, depending on the weather, a lot of times that spring of the year. But that gives us some good data. It gives us how have we done in the first 3 months of school. Also, if we use it as cumulative, gives the teacher a good understanding of it. And my students may really know this standard really well. I don't want to spend a lot of time on that, but they did very poorly on this standard, so I'm going to take the extra time I would have spent on this one and spend it on this standard. So it really guides their instruction, helps them plan their pacing and everything. Then a test in the spring, it gives us a good chance with that timing. We usually start the state test in mid-April. So we would have potentially 3 to 4 weeks there after the test in the spring to reteach standards that students aren't mastering, to understand those type of things. So it really allows us to hone in and focus.
Is this done by grade level, or would a teacher be able to customize a program for each individual student that's
This would be custom designed for Hawkins County, using questions that this company would develop that are aligned with the same standard of rigor that 10 ready questions are. The students at this pricing level, now there is another add-on feature that we could purchase for this, but it drives the cost up considerably, that they would have access to build their own assessments. Okay, there's a 70,000 question item bank that's available, but that comes in a additional cost. That pushes the 58 figure to about 74 or 80. So being realistic, also, no, actually that pushes it about 86. We looked at 2 times a year versus 3 times a year. When you look at the $8 per student for the testing itself, if you test 3 times a year, it's $11 per student. So trying to come to you with an appropriate thing. We think this is important. We think it would really help our students and our teachers. If you want to ask the staff, Beth, Dickie, they've been here, Angela, Leva. But
how long have these other students been utilizing the
school? I don't know exactly the number of years, I think. But Germantown's been doing it about 3 years, I think. I'm not positive.
That was stats to stagiate the growth or improvement or
access
to that.
One of the things we as board members hear often is that we're testing our kids too much. Another thing we hear is we're teaching to the test. How does this correspond to those allegations?
Well, when we give a state assessment in spring, that's how our students are measured by that test, our schools are measured by that test, and our districts are measured by that test. So we're saying that we've identified the standards that we're working toward, and we want students to master those standards. We've identified those as important. When we don't try to assess, so for example, we were going to head out and go to Memphis. We would like to know when we met Knoxville, when we went to Nashville, Reach Jackson. We'd like to know those waypoints, so to speak, along the way on our journey to make sure we're on the right direction and we're not in Paducah, we're not in Cincinnati, or we're not somewhere off course. And I think that's what this program kind of does for you. It makes sure that you're on course toward proficiency and mastery of the state standards. If there's going to be a test, and then somewhere along the way, somebody has identified that as being important. Just like the ACT is a junior, we've identified that as being important for students because we set a 21 threshold. I say we, the state, have set a 21 threshold to achieve a lottery scholarship or a hope scholarship. Colleges deem those scores to be important for admittance requirements because they'll publish the average ACT score of their freshman class. When they get into picking and choosing, if they only have so much room, we set a minimum score for students not to have to take remedial courses in college. We are very big with pushing the ACT work keys or the NCRC here in Thomas County because we feel there's value to that student to be able to leave school with a nationally recognized portable credential that tells potential employers they're career ready. So I think there's always going to be tests there looking, and we kind of thought about that as we talked about that, worked through this case. Our schools were already giving benchmark tests, but we've had to design those in-house, and they're working with those in-house. But the benefit of this is every school in our system will be able to take the same test, compare results, be able to, if I'm teaching something better than Jennifer, but Holly's teaching something better, one of the other standards better, and we have a chance, especially at our schools, to collaborate. What are you doing to get these results? Help me figure that out. Well, I see you're doing real well in this. Help me. So we get that collaboration.
Well, be able to do that right now.
Not when you're designing tests within a local school. You can do that within a school. But the students in Churchill Middle School aren't taking the same test as the students in Roger Middle School.
But the standards are the same.
Standards are the same. And we're asking our teachers to design those test items without the ability of the training to that level of questioning. So that's the key.
Is this 58,000 every year, once a year, and this contract is a one-year contract?
That's right.
And can it go up then the second year?
Could it go up, yes.
I have a question for Mr. Smith.
Which Mr. Smith?
And you may can answer this. The teacher leaders, I mean, are they, is this something that they're interested in from the schools?
The teacher leaders themselves in that position wouldn't be impacted necessarily by this. This would be more formative data for
the teachers. But don't they speak for the teachers in the school? I mean, the teachers are on board with this. They like this.
Yes.
They do.
All of the teachers in the meetings that I have with elementary teachers anyway, they will universally like the idea of a common assessment, which is what this gives you, that they can benchmark their students from Mooresburg to Mount Carmel. So you know where you're at.
Is there a piece of legislation that's been introduced to limit testing?
Several pieces of legislation. There's one that's puts a moratorium. There can't be any more tests from the state level added until 2021. There's another bill that says that teachers can't be held accountable for growth or TVAS until a test has been given successfully for 1 year, meaning you wouldn't be able to do that until the second year after it's been given successfully.
Assuming that would pass, how does this figure into that? Would that?
This would be absent of that. There's also the potential, there's talk potentially of maybe looking at eliminating the chemistry exam, possibility of maybe looking at using the adding writing to the ACT and eliminating the 11th grade English. Those are things that are just kind of being talked around.
The one that jumps out at me, I can't call the bill numbers, but it was one to limit testing to only the state mandated testing that's currently out there now.
I haven't seen that. There's a requirement through the RTI initiative that we give a benchmark 3 times a year, so that's going to be there.
This would meet that?
This would be in addition to that.
In addition to that.
We use a program called AIMSWeb for RTI and those students that are deemed to be deficient. Depending upon the tier they're in, they're either progress monitored, which again is more like a quiz that they're given weekly to measure their progress, either weekly or biweekly.
Do you know what this test looks like? Is it a lengthy, day-long test? Is it written test? Is it multiple choice? What kind of a test is it?
I would assume it's multiple question types, because when we look at state question, we'll have multiple choice, which we're very familiar. We'll have multiple answer, meaning that there's more than one correct answer. What other types of questions did you all see?
There are passages that I ran off. Long passages in some cases in middle school, you know, several paragraphs where they have to then say what was the main idea. You know, it's just not sure answer test. There's some of the questions. And we do kind of see it says within 72 hours you get the diagnostic report back from the there are questions that have more than one answer, like Steve said. Because that's on our test that we get in the state, that they have a state letter, but you know, there may be more than one correct answer within the ADCD. They seem very aligned to what we've seen. I think that we would have some say so in how wrong the test works, because we work with them to build these tests. They just don't do them without our help, you know. We would have some input into that.
Right now, typically, test from state 60 to 65 questions in a subject area. I don't think there's any more questions than that on a single test.
Well, I mean, when you look at, I haven't looked at one either, but when you look at, they give you the number of items per standard, and you can total those up. Good answer. We did meet with all the principals on February the 28th, and as a group, every single principal was in favor of this.
Oh, okay. That was my question. Were the teachers, is this what the majority of
them? We still have several of our teachers say, I wish we had something like global. It's not at the standard that 10 ready testing is, and that's the thing we want to make sure that when a student takes the state testing, it's not the first time they've seen those type of questions.
How late in the year is the second test?
We control when the tests start, so we would typically do that somewhere, like I said, around third, fourth week of February, first week of March, to give time to remediate before
10 ready,
which will start the second week of April. I think our window starts this year, April 12th, if I'm not mistaken.
There's not a possibility that this would be scored and used in conjunction with coming up with a grade performance or anything like that for a student.
We can set that and decide that we're not going to use this as a student's grade. We're just going to use this as an assessment purposes to help prepare that student. I'm sure that each student will be asked to set goals from the first test to the second test.
Right.
You know, discuss their results with them.
But they would receive a letter grade that would be incorporated somewhere in.
Wouldn't have to.
Further questions? Seems like it's very expensive.
It is. But as we've seen, most things are.
Yeah, we just talked about several million dollars, didn't we?
Yeah.
Your staff thinks it's well worth the $58,738 to determine where we stand in the benchmark assessment program. Would that be the overall?
I wouldn't speak for themselves.
Everybody in agreement? It's necessary? Everybody's nodding their head. Adrian's not.
And Adrian's just going to make sure that the computer's ready to test.
That's right. We'll make sure they test them.
Well, that's a good question. Is it written? Is it computerized? I know we tried to do that.
We have the ability that we can print the test out in Mira. That the third and fourth
will take the test on paper next year. Then for high school, it will all be assessed online.
And everybody has access to a device.
We would like to see that they would be to rotate them. A lot of our schools are getting very close to 1-1 now. Some of them are 1-1.
And I would also add, Mr. Barton, that if you've already mentioned the importance of state testing, we have an assessment, a formative assessment, that in fact we find to have that same predictability, 95 to 97% predictability. And we can make instructional decisions before they take that assessment at the end of the year. It would be valuable to us to be able to do that throughout the year instead of waiting until the end of that summative state test to find out how they do.
Where did this money take it from? Is this something Carl Perkins money to be used for, or is it local dollars?
The local dollars. There's talk in the we'll get to it. I guess it's number 7 there. There's talk about adding an item to the BEP formula, but this would be shifting something around. You know, if we 2 or 3 people retire and we replace those with first year teachers, just depending on how we got to that point.
Good. That's what we're trying to balance. Right. Is anybody opposed to this? Recommended. Number six is transportation bus driver salaries.
Ms. Jennifer, we're passing two documents around. One will be our current bus driver salary scale, and another one will be a proposed bus driver salary scale.
Mr. Starks, if we could, after we finish this one, can we take a 10-minute break or so, just as we finish this one?
Sure.
It's not going to be too lengthy. I'm sorry, go ahead.
As you know, I know with our struggles to continue to find drivers, and I've worked very hard at trying to attract people to drive, but I think as most people now are seeing with 3% unemployment, it is a challenge. I may have mentioned it, I can't remember if it was with you all or not, but I'll mention it again just in case. That a person comes in and decides that they want to be a bus driver. First of all, they have to go pass a DOT physical. They have to be drug tested. They have to pass four written tests. They have to be trained and go and do a driving test. Then after they've done all those things, background check, after they've done all those things, then they have to provide them 4 years of additional training before they can go drive the first place. So that is a challenge to get somebody to go through all those steps and make it to the end to be able to be a driver. So again, it's kind of a market-driven type thing. Be my recommendation that you look at a $3 per day increase bus driver salaries. That would put the lower end of the scale for substitutes with 0 years experience at $60 a day. Obviously, would adjust every other step, $3 a day as well. And compensating, though, there is a lot of responsibility for our bus drivers. We now know, and think that this would be. Hopefully be another way. We continue. Last year we increased the pay. Seems like we've increased the pay. If the $3 is acceptable, we would have increased the pay about $13.33, I think it was. 46.67 or something like that. A few years back. So this would increase that pay. About $13.37 a day over the last few years.
How would this put us in ranking with the surrounding counties?
It's hard to really get a fix on that. We are one of the few that gives them access to benefits. Some systems will employ them as six-hour custodians, and I'm driving a bus on each end of that. Some systems we'll pay them an 8-hour day and then do other things. But I think it does make us competitive with only requiring 4 to 5 hours of their time a day to do that. $60, again, thinking about it from this standpoint, if you get a minimum wage job, for example, at 7 1/4, and you work 8 hours, that's $58. So again, this is $2 more than having to work 8 hours a day for that type of job. So again, hopefully it's an enticement and have a part-time job that would pay them. We continue to do the first year until they are eligible for benefits in the second year. The first year, we would reimburse them up to $350 a month to purchase private insurance. And we added that this past year. And there have been some that have taken us up on that. But that would stay in effect. Then once they've been employed with us a year, they would have access to our benefits and be paid at the same level all other employees are.
What's the financial impact of $3 increase?
It's on one of the scales, and the highlight at the bottom of the 18-19 scale.
Will we be adding to the transportation budget other places as well?
There is a potential add. We'll go on down and talk about it in another area. This question usually comes up. I'll go ahead and answer this. I've been mistaken on my recollection. Our bus debt will fully pay off in the 2021 year. So 18-19, 19-20, 20-21, so we have 3 years worth of debt to pay off. We'll be out of debt in transportation. It's my wishful thinking that we'll be out sooner than.
As far as maintenance, fuel costs, do we anticipate increases in any of that?
Fuel costs right now stabilized the first of the year. We were running up, and I was concerned about fuel costs. We are going to have to budget a little bit of increase in fuel costs just because of the uncertainty. But right now, fuel costs have came back down since that one of these centers.
The recommendation being $3 per day increase for bus drivers. Anybody opposed to that? If it helps in recruitment and retainment of drivers, I think we would be in favor of it. We'd like to include that as a recommendation. With that said, can we take a 10-minute break?
Nobody ever said it out loud. Oh.
Bus drivers.
I thought, it must be really bad. Nobody said it out loud. I got a murderous day tomorrow. I got a bunch of stories left over to write. I got to get a chance to speed right now. I got a lot of stories to write.
Solid
ones to write. How you doing, Matt?
4 o'clock.
I'll have to do this without me.
I'm thinking about this thing.
They have a lot of them.
$58,034.50.
Okay. All right. 58.
34.
34.
50 cents.
How many bus drivers do you guys have right now? You know how many you have?
We have 85 right now.
How many do you need?
We need about 5 or 6.
That's good.
We hope. We just got a new driver the other day. I think he started last week, if I'm not mistaken.
Yeah. See, if I was retired and I needed money to get supplemental insurance, health insurance, that would be the perfect thing to do.
And that's what we've done for a long time. That's been the enticement. There's farmers, a lot of times used to, and they have benefits or something. They would drive buses and then we get into retirees.
Yeah.
We have about four right now, people that are retired in the system, and they come back and they drive us a sub.
Oh, okay.
Because they can't, they can work so many hours without affecting their retirement,
yeah.
They can't be considered full-time employees.
Right.
Yeah. When it's old, I'm thinking about that. I think I'm 70, I'm probably a little while.
Past. You know, we had a guy that just retired here that was
80.
Mr.
I think that guy from
Seville. Another guy that retired. Oh. He hadn't been that work, but the guy you're thinking about, I think he was.
He drove for 57 or 58 years, something like that, right?
Yeah. He was. So if he was 20 when he started, he'd been 77,
yeah.
Right? So, yeah, he was somewhere about 86. It's all dependent on passing the physical.
Yeah.
Your blood pressure is in order, and you're not diabetic, and those type of things.
I think he just does
heart
scans.
What school was he talking about? I got here late. What school was he talking about?
The very beginning?
Yeah.
Kepler.
Yeah.
Based on the, and that's something I wanted the board to know before they had to make decisions about the investing, is the condition of the structure, was it structurally sound, those type of things.
Say it's still safe.
Yes, it's still safe, but there are going to be issues that need to be addressed. And looking at that, it's not just going up there and stretching a new membrane over the roof. It's going to cost, you know, require additional things, as Mr. Wilson talked about. The original part of the building. So when you, if you look at the school, you walk in the front door, the gym's to your left, you have your cafeteria, those type of things, and then you have about halfway down the building, you have the original structure, which was built in 1950. Then there's an addition that we talked about. It's a newer part of the building. We always call it the new wing. It's a slab on grade. It already has bar glass on the roof, so there's some value to that structure. Not, it doesn't have the issues that a wood frame structure would have. And it was built in 1960.
That was the bottom line.
Right now, he talked about if you were in the range they were seeing as they were bidding schools that are being built up there, 175 to 190. If you were starting from scratch, it could be in the $200 range. So, again, it's the market, it's the materials, those type of things.
$175 to $190.
If you get into demolition too, that would be starting and grading the site off and starting from the ground up. If you're getting into demolition and having to do some of that stuff, it's probably going to be closer probably to 200 square feet.
If you tear the whole thing down.
Be my guess.
How many students?
A little over 100.
So, to Peter's men, it's still smaller.
No, actually, they're about identical this year. McFeeder's been and has grown a little bit. They're right around the 100 mark as well. And plus, we've added a Head Start classroom partnership for the Head Start.
Are we going to see this on the agenda?
That to be what we decide to do. We had to need to make some decisions as part of our five-year capital projects. The roof estimate for Kepler was on there. And our roof estimate, I think, was $215 for the entire school.
it's not going to do it.
Yeah, you don't have to worry about the roof, don't you?
Huh?
You got a lot to worry about on that building. $2 million worth.
If they chose to leave everything, I'm saying it's over to me. Be my guess.
That would be if it was if you tore it down and started over, or
no, to tear if you factor the entire school at 19,000 square feet, and you say the new addition is, as we call it, is 9,000 square feet. 10,000 square feet torn down, started over at $200 a square, is $2 million. And that doesn't put a new roof on the new addition or repoint the brick and those type things, cosmetic things.
That's just tearing down the old,
tearing down in the 50
portion and
redoing it
and not touching the roof on the
1960s. Doesn't put a new filter plant in.
That's something else that's needed.
The one there is working and it's in compliance and everything, but the way it was built is a liner was stretched in it. Then piping and rock was put in there as a filter bed.
Oh, Lordy.
So to redo the liner,
the numbers got up.
You got to take the rock and the pipe up, so you're basically redoing it.
You got to do what you got to do, you know?
Yeah. Do you spend $2 million on a 70-year-old school, or do you transfer them, or do
that's
you
why they make the big money?
Yeah, boy.
They make the hard decisions.
That's why they give me $84 a month, ain't it? It's that's a tough one. I mean, it really is. I mean, have you been to Kepler? Have you seen
it? I know
it?
Where it is. I haven't been in it. I've driven by it.
I've been in it one time. I mean, it looked like every school I went to school in, but I went to school 40 years ago.
Yeah. Me too. And those schools I went to are now closed. I went to Cedar Grove and Bloomingdale, and every one of those schools up there in Bloomingdale are closed. Gravely, Brookside, Cedar Grove, Kingsley, Lynn Garden. Every one of them are closed.
I went to the city school of the line. It was about a quarter as big as it is now.
Yeah. But you take his numbers and you start adding all the soft money on top of that with plumbing, electrical, and I think that could get over $2 million real quick. And
you still got a 70-year-old
building. Yeah, still got a 70-year-old building. So do you buy property and build another one in the community for 100 students? Or do we send them 8 miles up the road?
I wouldn't want to be in your shoes.
No, it's anything you do is not going to be good. And see, I think the county commission will be reluctant to give us any money on renovation. We can't get a bond. Can't do a bond on it now because of our financial situation. So I think we're really in a pickle.
You can't do bond. Where would the money come? You can't sell bonds.
Well, I think what you're going to have to do is have a public forum, and you're going to have to invite everybody in and just say, this is the fact.
See,
this is the reality.
What happens, Jeff, is that those commissioners representing that community will take their side, but yet they won't fund you any money to do what you need to do. I mean, we need $2 million, so if you want to keep it open, you need to fund us $2 million. But they'll vote against that.
Yeah, they're talking about cutting, you know, putting a moratorium on spending.
Yeah.
Like that.
Yeah.
You know they're not going to
go for it. What happened up at Weaver was that they said that it was structurally unsafe. So I thought if he came back and he said that would be, you know, a directive we can follow.
You don't have to make any immediate decisions.
No, but we're going to have to do something.
Yeah. This one's talking about a 3-inch.
Yeah. Yep, in the roof.
If you need to hear what the engineer said, then you can go on Facebook and read this. You're a citizen just like everybody else.
It started at 6. I don't know how late it was when I got here.
You must have 10 minutes.
10 or 7. I snuck up on him. I was doing something. Looked up at 6 o'clock.
Yeah, I thought I was going to make it. That's not a lot of stories. We don't know what to say.
All right, let's get started back if we can. Stopped at number 7. District RTI BB funding 10-month position.
Okay.
That's what that is.
Should have a paper coming around. And the governor's proposed budget. And the talk of putting in, adding a component to the BEP. Right now, there's 45 components in the BEP. This would be a component that would be added. The BEP committee has recommended 3 things. The first was to reduce the ratio for funding of nurses from 1 to 3,000 and 1 to 750. That didn't make it in. Another thing was to increase funding for RTI. This is what you would consider one of those unfunded mandates, I think, that we're required to do RTI. We need to do RTI. I'm not opposed to RTI. Actually, I'm proponent of it, but it does come at a cost. And so the thing that did make it into the proposed budget, also there's additional legislation that goes so far as doing 3 positions for every school. So we'll see where we land, but in the proposed budget, there is additional funding for RTI. Again, that's a portion of a position. 70% based on our ability to pay, we fluctuate from there a little bit. We pick up 27-28% of that position. But you can see there that, and I asked this question in the meeting, that regarding the RTI position as proposed would be a requirement for every district. The answer was if it's in the budget, it's the expectation for districts to utilize it. And you see some of the other things I've highlighted. All districts must identify an RTI lead, meaning somebody at the district level that's responsible for RTI.
Do we currently have some?
We do have that shared, and as we went into last year, the hats keep piling on. Mr. Hudson took on pre-K, Ms. Holt took on middle school, Mr. Wesley Smith took on CTE, so we've continued to add roles and responsibilities, and those are sizable roles and responsibilities. So right now, our champions are Ms. Holt and Ms. Jackson kind of lead our BEP efforts, but when you're doing a lot of these other things, this would be somebody, and what we're proposing is taking, if it's funded, pending funding, is taking and creating a position, a 10-month position when we're in school, somebody that goes around and works with all the RTI positions that are in the school. We do have an RTI person at every school, 3 through 8, or K through 8, sorry. Still focused on the testing. And then we, as part of a teacher's workload at the high schools, we're doing RTI as well there. Now, when I say RTI, again, we're acronym for response to intervention and instruction. Or it's response to instruction and intervention. But be my recommendation that we would have a lead at the district level that could work with all the folks in the school that are responsible for RTI, be able to see something, we're really doing well in one school, be able to replicate that across our district, follow up, and they would report back to a district level position, but this would be somebody very similar to, or akin to our instructional coaches, that they would be working directly with those responsive intervention lead teachers at the schools, leading that initiative for our system.
So with some of the RTI instructors we have currently?
We have one at, well, I'll take that back. We have a half a position at Kepler and Peter Finn. The person that does RTI there is a special ed teacher, so they're half-time special ed and half-time RTI. The rest of the schools, except for the 2 high schools, have one person that is the lead RTI person at that school. Now, there's other people involved in that. They're
sure that organizing the 4.5 meetings, making sure that assessing the kids, those type things, while other employees are working with students on their individual deficits and reading the math.
How many do you have at the high schools?
We have one person devoted in math, and we have one person in English, and each of the high schools do a little bit differently. But there's kind of a person that they've kind of taken on the role of being the lead, but there's other people involved in kind of part of their teaching flow. They may have a period here or something like that.
So is that two at each high school?
But they also teach, for example, if it's a math teacher, they teach math, which they teach algebra one or whatever, but one of their periods in each. We do RTI at high school during the singleton, and during the singleton, every teacher teaches. So they would still have three block classes of math, for example, but they would be doing RTI during that singleton period, or they would have three blocks of English. They'd be doing RTI during the singleton period.
The RTI lead, would they be housed at central office and then be floating from school to school? Is that how that would work? And what pay scale would you put them at?
Teacher pay, system wide teacher pay scale.
Is that different than just?
Yes, we have a 10-month teacher scale, and then we have a system wide scale. Again, it's a 10-month position, but that is a requirement under the or been in place for several years. For example, our speech teachers are considered system wide, and they go to multiple schools and those type of things. Consulting teachers operate on a system wide scale.
And I assume this is a new position, right?
It would require board approval of adding a new position.
And I guess it depends on the person's number of years of service in education, depending on what we would budget for it.
We would try to estimate an average there, but we would try to get the best person we could in the position. But we would estimate, and we may estimate middle of the road, 15 years of master's or something like that. Try to estimate it.
Shifting of funds to allow for this? Are we eliminating anything else that would make this softer on the budget?
Be getting additional funding if it's put in the budget as an additional component in the BEP, so it would be a position funded at 70%+ through the state, through the BEP formula. So,
and to understand that they are going to fund it, we just don't know what rate.
If the budget is approved now, other legislation passes, we could get up to three per school. So again, it just depends on how the legislation works out, if the budget's approved. This is what the governor's budget has right now for one position.
I think the financial part of the three per school will probably get that one.
It would be a challenge, I think.
Yeah.
And again, you know, it's, when you're talking about teacher line, for example, page 10 of your budget, if I'm not mistaken, that one page is over half of our budget, general purpose school budget. So there is some variability there, dependent upon how many people retire. If we have somebody that leaves and goes to another system, we hire a number of people, so it's rare.
Okay, any questions, Mr. Starnes? About RTI lead position. This is a new position, and we partially funded by the BEP funding formula.
Be the recommendation of this workshop that I put down on the next board agenda and condition a pending state funding to be able to create that position.
Would we need to do it before we, rather than just putting it in our budget for next year, would we need to go ahead and do it now?
We can do it either way. We can go ahead and do it in the budget, and if the budget's approved, the position's approved, or we can go ahead and approve
six of one, half dozen of another.
Speak on the matter. What's your all's pleasure? Somebody agreed to wait and see if it's approved at state level before we include it in the budget?
I would think so.
All right. That seems needed.
So wait on the approval.
Yes, sir. I don't think there's great opposition
and
to it.
You would have to vote on the budget, right?
Yeah. And if you've got problems, then that's
so that would be the thing if put it in and if the budget is approved.
Yeah.
The approval of the position.
Yes. Yeah. Those that aren't here, they'll have questions about that, but maybe they'll inquire. Okay. And moving on to number 8, computer technician levels 1 and 2.
I'd like to recognize Mr. Adrian Smith, our technology supervisor.
Give you all a little bit of start with a little bit of history, if I may. About 22 years ago, there was one person that worked in the technology department, and at that time, we didn't have computers in every classroom. At that time, it was a transition from a typing lab over to a computer lab for the purpose of typing. That was the original use. They were not networked. They didn't have switches. We didn't have cables pulled throughout the schools. We didn't have laptops at that time. What we did have was ended up getting moving from one person working in the department to two people, to three people. Then we start getting laptop computers. We get networks that come in. We get wires that are pulled. And some of the people that were responsible for that is here in this room tonight. And that's not me. We start getting laptops. We start getting wireless access points. We start getting computers in every classroom. Then we start for the teachers. And then we start getting computer labs for students spread throughout the district. Now we've then moved to wireless computers, laptops, iPads, and now it's Chromebooks. Each step that we've taken, that's another pot or another item, another system that we have to work with. We started with one person in the department. We moved to five, the most being six with technicians or network administrators or technicians at one time, and we're back to five currently. I'm not here to say we need more people, and I don't think that the folks that are here would say we need additional people. What I am saying is that the scale that you have in front of you there are two copies. You have one, which is the current, and then you have the proposed being the simplified one. And I would say that if you look at the first step on that, or zero, actually the first column, the national average falls between those two. Yes, ma'am.
National average being
$34,894.
Tell us the difference between a Tech 1 and a Tech 2.
Tech 1 is not necessarily someone that comes in and starts a Tech 1. We may have a network administrator that we would hire in at Tech 2. It depends on the duties. So it's not time spent in the system. It's the duties or the systems that they are responsible for. The workload, so to speak. So it's possible for somebody to move from Tech 1 to Tech 2. Of course, we're not going to move anybody back generally from Tech 2 to Tech 1. But they can migrate from that, so it is an incentive to take on more responsibilities reward those folks for doing that, and also enable us to be able to be competitive in the marketplace, in the job place.
And the, how many of each one of those do you have?
Have proposed right now, because this is a new scale. We don't identify them that way now, but proposed there would be 3 Tech 2s and 2 Tech 1s.
Still trying to get a handle on what is discretionary when a person moves from 1 to 2. Is it skill-based or is it responsibility-based, or how's that work?
So, for example, if we had a active directory administrator, then that would be one of those duties, and it's, but there may be 5 of those jobs underneath that one person has that would qualify them as being Tech 2. We may have someone that is a phone systems person that may have that as their only large duty. They would be at level 1 until they reached enough of those jobs, those bigger, higher level jobs under their umbrella that they would then move to Tech 2. So it's not, we don't have anybody that just does one thing. Everybody wears multiple hats. We have people that do software technician. They also do hardware active directory. They also do network or administration of the Google administration or the Google console. So we're talking about a lot of different systems that take a lot of time. Having to drop one thing, pick another thing up, drop this and go to another. So it's knowledge spread out everywhere.
For example, say we had somebody who was responsible for maintaining our entire network, maintaining all of our servers, making sure that our email was optimal, making sure that all of our camera servers work. Other various functions, but those kind of high-level things compared to a position that was going out and installing workstations, repairing printers, those type of things. So again, it is skill and knowledge, but it's also the number of different things that they know as well. Obviously, if our network's not up, everything doesn't matter. Working or not, if we can't access our network, we're not very efficient. Those type of things. So it's those critical duties. And that's not to say that it's not important to be able to go out and install a classroom lab or something. But the amount, level of responsibility rests within that particular person's job or whatever.
Who does, do the techs do work with teachers in terms of trying to bring them up to speed on new technology, or who does that piece of it?
That would be your instructional technology leaders, formerly the curriculum specialist, the technology curriculum specialist.
Yeah.
So that position was absorbed and redistributed to the instructional technology leaders.
Every school has one of those. High schools have 2.
Okay. So we have somebody, at least one person at every campus to take care of that, where at one person taking care of 19.
Does the Tech 2 have supervisory responsibilities over?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
And you would oversee all the positions?
Yes, sir.
What's the average experience of the techs?
We have 22, 16, 8, 6, and 1 years experience.
Impressive.
Am I wrong on that? Correct, please. In the district experience. I apologize. So inside the district, we're looking at the pay scale. We're looking at for next year, it would be 1, 6, 8, 16, and 22. And you can see the difference down there at the very bottom of the new scale. That would be the cost for next year. With that applied to those employees. Our current employees. To give you something else to think about, to give another figure, the state Tennessee, not Tennessee Department of Education, but the state of Tennessee, they have a network administrator, and part of the functions of our department is administering the network, and we have basically one person that does that, but he wears multiple hats besides just the network administration. The starting pay for the state of Tennessee is $65 less, $65 more than what's on the top end of that right there on 31 at level 2. And then it ranges all the way up to about $2,500 more per month, to give you an illustration of what these folks are doing.
These positions don't require a specific degree in technology, though.
They don't. And oftentimes, I will say this, the knowledge that we have in our department right now, we could not replace. You can't replace it. I equate it to, and I'm not comparing to or anything else, but whenever I was at the high school, I was told to mirror the custodian that had been there since it was built, that when he leaves the place, nobody's going to know where anything is. And I took that to heart. And I didn't follow him around all the time, but I mirrored him as often as I could. And there was, I found out everything from, okay, if the lights, every other light is on, and you walk in the class or in the hallway, then you know exactly to go out to the vocational building and look up the pole. There's been a squirrel that crawled across the line and kick the fuse on the pole. So that's the same kind of thing that we have now. We have that knowledge. We have the people on staff right now that have pull all of those wires, know where every single switch is, are intimate with all those computers that we have in place. If we can't bring somebody in that's going to have that knowledge and that background of what is going on in Hawkins County tomorrow, it would take years to get that, to get us back to where we are.
Well, I think we all know that the Tech 1 and 2 are underpaid presently, and the market is demanding a lot more pay-wise than what we're paying. So the overall impact was $14,467 currently, providing nobody to leave. And then the corresponding benefits that go along with that salary, right?
Yes, sir.
All right.
And I would...
Any questions? Anyone opposed to recommending the increase to our technology folks, Tech 1 and 2, and the increases that are outlined in the proposal? Seeing none, it looks like it's a recommendation. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Smith. Thank you.
Okay, going on to non-certified salary increase. Proposed maybe an increase for teacher pay. This is
again, looking at the governor's proposed budget, the governor has only has invested quite a bit of money over the years during his tenure in education. The proposal in this year's budget is to invest a little over $55 million going toward teacher pay increases. We've not seen what that looks like. Probably won't see that until we get our first BEPS. But having said that, we know our certificate staff are going to receive a teacher pay increase. Do you wish for me to budget a non-certificate salary increase as well?
Yes. I think that would be the answer to that, but without knowing what the governor is going to do, how are you able to project that?
Well, we've done the fact what the governor does won't affect our non-certificated staff. And what we've done in the last couple of years, we've looked at $2 a day, for example. I think that's what we've done the last 2 years. Prior to that, it's been percentage-based. So I'm just asking for proposal of direction from the board to what do you wish me to construct the budget with, and then we'll look at it and go from there.
Do you wish to think that some of these would pay the bus drivers?
$0.25 on the hour last year, which I think
was
about
$2 a day.
$2. From all we're hearing is that the governor's race is going to be significant this year on his. Equal and with as much parity as we can do and afford. So I'm saying I think yes we ought to, but I don't know how to put a percentage or an amount on it.
$2 per day. If I'm not mistaken, the last 2 years. Does that sound right, Wes?
Do you have an idea of the impact on $2 a day for non-certified?
Probably until we calculated all the salaries and everybody in their place and everything. I wouldn't have thought about it.
And I hate like cents, $2 an hour. When we might want to do $2.50 or we might.
When we do $2 an hour, might be old.
I mean, close to that. Oh, everybody's making money.
Be popular, man. Start with $2 a day, and then once we see kind of where we're at,
we could tweak it. I think that that's probably a good starting point since we're in the first meeting of our budget. Is everybody in agreement that we start there and work off that? Is it okay?
That's good.
That's the recommendation. Okay, that's number 9. We'll move on to number 10: retirement rate for legacy employees.
While Jennifer's passing this out, I'll give you a quick explanation of it.